There's no doubt about it. This is one of the most cataclysmic elections that we've ever faced as a nation. Everything goes down Tuesday, right? I've been equating it to a hurricane. A hurricane has been way in the distance, and I've been studying and following this hurricane for about 3 decades, way out there in the distance. And I said to myself, there's no way. It's a pipe dream for a hurricane to hit our nation. But I've watched it, and I've seen it develop. It developed with pre-modernity. That's when man looked to God for significance. Then modernity. That's when man, for the first time, looked away from God to something else for his vitality and peace. And then post-modernity, from 1960 until today, we've looked inside of ourselves for truth. So the enemy has used this scheme, this hurricane. He's used people, as we've been talking about, like Karl Marx, like Friedrich Nietzsche, like Sigmund Freud. He's used all of these things, from critical theory to postmodernistic thought, from postmodernistic thought to socialism. The list is limitless, and it started this hurricane, and the hurricane has hit our country with a crazy force. I mean, this hurricane makes a Cat 5 look like a summer storm. It's that big. And if you've ever been in a hurricane, or I'm sure you know this about hurricanes, one of the most dangerous parts in a storm is the debris that can fly. The debris off of a roof, maybe a limb, the debris, even a car, it can cause massive damage. So that's what's been happening to the very foundations of who we are. Wouldn't you agree? Think about the debris that this hurricane, I call the hurricane El Woco, that this hurricane has levied and has pushed against you and me and our very foundations. Now, when I say wokeism, some people are like, well, what is wokeism? Because wokeism is difficult to define. It's like nailing Jell-O to the wall. But here's a good definition. Wokeism is an authoritarian worldview that seeks to deconstruct the foundations of our Christian faith, I just talked about that, by overwhelming, overpowering, and overthrowing those who do not adhere to its ideology. That, friends, is what we're facing. A hurricane is all about collisions, and then I want to talk to you today about the different collisions that we're going to have and that we're seeing as we go to the ballot box. I like what someone said about woke. They said woke, W-O-K-E. That's willfully overlooking known evil. You know, we kind of smile, but that's so true. The gospel of woke. There's a gospel. The problem is oppression. The solution is activism. And the goal is simply power and control. That's the gospel according to woke. Now, the gospel of God is our problem is sin, our solution is Jesus Christ, and the goal is love. So we see the difference. So when it comes to this storm, this debris flying around, it's a good versus evil situation. It's Christianity versus wokeism. And it shouldn't shock us that only 4% of Generation Zs have a biblical worldview. A biblical worldview is that panoramic perspective that all of us have, even if we don't know we have a worldview, we have one. I'm telling you, you do. God's worldview, I would say, is the worldview. based on Scripture. It is the only worldview. If you think about God, He established these institutions. He established Genesis chapter 2, the family. God established the church, Acts chapter 2. And then in Romans 13, He established the state. So the Bible was speaking about these issues long before we even said the word politics. But if you want to argue politics, because some people say, well, why is the church talking about politics? I want to ask, why isn't the church talking about politics? Throughout the Bible, you have the matriarchs and patriarchs talking and dealing with politics. Even Jesus. Politics basically is just an outflowing of a system of beliefs that a person has. So the church is the best place, in my opinion, to talk about politics. Sometimes, as I said last time, people go, well, how about separation of church and state? Here is what the wokists have done. The wokists have taken great words, great concepts off the pages of Scripture, hijacked them, twisted them, and they've redefined them. Separation of church and state goes back to the 1800s with Thomas Jefferson. He was just responding to a letter that a bunch of Baptists wrote to him. And the essence of his usage of separation of church and state means that the state, the nation, the government should get its nose out of the church's business. But he never meant for the church to get their influence out of the government's business. So that's bogus when people say that. They don't know their history. Furthermore, from the 1700s until the 1800s, there were hundreds and hundreds of political sermons preached from pulpits around our land. So what I'm doing today is old school. Turn to your neighbor and say, this is old school. This is nothing new. And then you think about the Christian roots. There was a book that a Duke scholar wrote that came out like in 1930, something like that. And this scholar talked about how the Declaration of Independence, all of those concepts, and many of those phrases were concepts and phrases that pastors had preached from pulpits. And these guys just kind of, I wouldn't say plagiarized them, but, you know, they just put them in an order. And we have a Christian root in America, Christian values. We stand upon those. But again, a lot of people have tried to hijack and rewrite history. Well, when it comes to voting, though, I mean, when it comes to facing this hurricane, how can we face this flying debris? Because really, the most secure place to face this debris is going to be here in the church, right? But as you vote, what should you ask yourself? I voted a couple of days ago, and I asked myself these same questions. So I want to sort of throw out the questions I asked, and maybe they'll help you, because I do have a Christian worldview, if you're wondering. Number one, here's what you need to ask yourself. Which candidate will best protect God's design for biological sex? I can't believe I'm even saying that. But that's pretty obvious, isn't it? The sexualization of children, transgenderism. If I identify as a girl, I can go into women's restrooms and play sports with girls? That's insanity. So which one is going to honor that? Because the Bible only gives us one option when it comes to sex. One man, one woman in marriage, that's it. Yeah, but one man, one woman in marriage. But one man, one woman in marriage. Here's the second question. You're facing this hurricane, so am I. Which candidate stands for religious liberty? You realize in Canada, if I preach this message, I could be arrested. And if we pick the wrong person, the wrong group, it's just a matter of time, because I'm telling you something, they're coming after you and they're coming after me. They are. And I don't say that as some scare tactic or, wow, that sounds like you have a tinfoil hat on. Just read about these things that I'm talking about. Just read about the roots of this storm and how it's formed. Number three, which candidate, I ask myself this, protects freedom of speech and a right to bear arms? It's pretty big. I love the fact that we have freedom of speech, but isn't it fascinating that so many are tamping our freedom of speech? So many people are canceling and shadow banning us. And I've even been a part of it. So has our church. Freedom of speech? It's a lost art. Number four, which candidate protects the lives of developing babies? There are 200,000 abortions a day. 200,000. And right before I walked out here, a group of us, we were kind of going over this message as I normally do after I've studied. And we were talking about how horrible this is. And so someone Googled the most important species to protect. That's what she Googled. You know what it was? A bee. Wow. Now, I love bees, don't get me wrong. Bees play a critical role, but bees? Okay. Number five, which candidate underscores and highlights Christ's values for the family? Those transcendent values, that's a good question. Which candidate stands with Israel? Of course, that's pretty obvious. Which candidate protects our borders? We have to protect our borders. I am all about people coming into the U.S. I think it's great, but they have to do it in the right way. But we're just swinging the doors open and come on in. And as we see, so many countries are simply sending us some of their worst. Now, obviously, all of them aren't the worst, but that's a serious situation. And then here's one too. I love this one. Who endorses the candidates? Now, when the secular media is behind you and Hollywood and all those A-listers, when they're behind you, you've got to go, There's a battle going on, a collision going on, El Woco's going on, a storm is going on, debris is flying around. Well, debris, like truth versus relativism. Here we go again, truth versus relativism. Relativism is some debris that's trying to take out truth. The Bible says in Proverbs 11:3, the integrity of the upright guides them, but the unfaithful are destroyed by their duplicity. Integrity, I like the word grit in it. Integrity means a whole number. A half-truth with another truth is still a half-truth. Truth is truth. There are absolute truth out there. There's objective truth out there. And relativism seeks to say, okay, truth is sort of a moving target. It's up to your context. It's up to your background. It's up to your emotions. Yet if we live that way completely and totally, it would be Absolutely nuts. Have you seen these anti-spam apps? Do you have any of those on your devices? Anti-spam apps? The cool thing about these things is they constantly search all of our devices, and when they ever come across anything that could pollute our devices or mess us up, they warn us. That is the kind of app we need as we're making these decisions, because let me say it again, we're not voting for a person. It's not the orange man or the cackling hyena. No, we're voting for platforms, policies, the trajectory of where everything is going. That's what we're voting on. And again, people say, well, he or she, they just don't check off all the boxes. Well, when are we ever 100% about anything? Truth versus relativism. How about responsibility versus victimization? One party, one platform is all about responsibility. If you take Christ's words in the parables, half of them, just as Jesus, were about taking personal responsibility. This is Jesus. And sometimes people have said this to me, well, I think Jesus was a socialist. No, I turn them to the parables. And then some people will say, well, look at the early church in Acts 2. I mean, they were definitely Marxist, sharing everything. Yes, they did share everything, but it was voluntary. No other church mentioned in Scripture did that. And I think it's a good thing. So when you try to parse these things and do gymnastics and hijack words, it can go off the ranch very, 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 very quickly. So responsibility versus victimization. We love to play the victim, don't we? And we have one person who's leading the charge who's all about the victim mentality. The victim mentality. Think about Fedzilla. Think about our government. We have over 19 million employees in the government. 19 million. And we've created it in such a way that we say, wow, the government knows more about my life than anyone. And we say, you know, I'm a victim, so I deserve this and I deserve that. And it's been created now to where single women with kids can marry Fedzilla. They don't have to work, and they make enough money to just do what they do. So Fedzilla has replaced, in many situations and circumstances, the man. And then Fedzilla loves to assault our achievement, doesn't he? He simply takes from people who are responsible, working hard, and then he redistributes the wealth. Obviously, if someone cannot help themselves, that's where the church steps up. That's where our government can step in. But if someone is able to work and we're paying them all this money, that just doesn't work. It doesn't work. So wisdom versus intelligence is something else. Wisdom comes from God. Intelligence comes from man. And am I the only one that looks at some of these educated idiots and I say to myself, why in the world are they making this decision? That's totally against common sense. But as I've discovered, common sense is uncommon. We only have true common sense when we live by a Christian worldview. So in reality, you know, and I love the U.S. Little government, big freedom. Big government, little freedom. And you just look back over the decades as we look at El Woco, our freedoms are getting smaller and smaller and smaller. Another tension point is effectiveness versus bureaucracy. I kind of hit on that earlier. We need to be effective. Our government obviously should protect us, build roads and bridges and things of that, maybe in education and some other things. But after that, I believe we should take, again, that R word, responsibility for who we are in Christ. It's a biblical mandate as we live out responsibility, as we work, as we invest, as we help others. Everyone is not going to end up equally. Let me say that again. Everyone is not going to end up equally. I do, though, believe we should have equal opportunity, but the outcome, that's the whole beauty about our system. And Jesus talked about that in so many of his parables. So effectiveness versus bureaucracy. Oh, I have this down here. You know, the Bible has 727,696 words. Did you know that? Our tax code has 10,067,000 words. Is that unbelievable? And what's so funny, let me just say this for a second, I can vent. You know, so many people in the government arrest citizens for what they're doing. And I saw someone say this the other day, is it true that our entire government is turning into a Ponzi scheme? Think about that one. Tolerance versus intolerance. Tolerance, the way we grew up with the word acceptance. I accept you, I accept everybody. The new tolerance is, I have to accept you, approve you, applaud you, and if I don't do that, they're gonna take me out. That's the new stuff. Oh, here's something cool. I want you to write this down very, very fast. And I have 2 minutes to do this. I have a lot of different lists in this talk. Normally, I don't have that many lists, but I just had to do it. To vote is a formal expression of preference for a candidate for office or for a proposal resolution of an issue. Some of these collisions are over this. And it's easy to differentiate which side we're talking about. God, man, unity, division, responsibility, victimization, humility, power, truth, deception, tolerant, intolerant, eternal, temporal, logical, illogical, consistency, absurdity, a high view of man, or a low view of man. That's what we're facing. So you have an opportunity as a believer to vote your conscience, to vote your biblical worldview, to vote your platform, the policy that you feel that best reflects the transcendent values of our great God. Jesus did say this about a hurricane. You know, Jesus talked about a hurricane. He did. Matthew chapter 7. Here's what he said. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the, say it with me, rock. The rains came down, the streams rose. Sounds like a hurricane to me. And the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. Friends, we can rock the vote. And the rock is Jesus. Let's bow for prayer. I want us, if we can, just to find a place to kneel, because I want to pray especially, and there's enough room between the seats, if you're physically able, I want to especially pray for this time as a nation. I know it's kind of difficult to kneel on the balcony, but thank you for doing that. Dear Heavenly Father, you're so gracious. You're so amazing. You are our God. Jesus, you're our Savior and our Lord. And I pray, Lord, that our nation would understand what it means to be one nation under God, not alongside God or above God, under God. And I pray that every single person hearing my voice would carry out your mandate, God, to vote, to choose the platform that best reflects you and your word. I know some here maybe would even disagree with some of the things we talked about today, and that's okay. That doesn't at all mean you can't come back, because we accept everybody. But we also accept you to such a degree that we want to tell you the truth. And here's what the Bible says. So, Father, protect us. Place your arm around America. And may we vote. And God, may the righteous rule. We ask all these things in Jesus' name.
Hi guys, thank you so much for watching the Ed Young YouTube channel.
That's right, and if you want to be inspired, encouraged, and challenged like never before, subscribe and click the notification button.
We believe this channel can help change your life.